Welcome to part two of GI, where we're going to talk about constipation and impaction. Constipation is the first bowel disorder we'll talk about in block one. And constipation is a very big problem in Arizona, and hopefully you'll be able to figure out why before I actually say it. Maybe you already know. Constipation is defined as fewer than three bowel movements weekly, or bowel movements that are hard, dry, small, or difficult to pass. Now, constipation can be very subjective for some people. Remember, we all have our own normal bowel habits, and any change to our norm can make us feel like we have constipation. We call this perceived constipation, and the word perceived makes it seem like it's all in our head, but I'll be very honest with you, it's a real thing. Sometimes just missing one normal bowel movement can make people feel horrible. Constipation can be caused by many things, including medications, chronic laxative use, weakness, immobility, fatigue, diet, ignoring the urge to defecate, inadequate liquid intake, and lack of regular exercise. This is why we ask so many questions of our patients when we assess the GI tract, because there's so many reasons why a person can have issues. We discuss the types of stool, and if you notice, the definition of constipation does mention a specific type of stool. Constipation stool can look different depending on what's causing it. So lack of fluid intake or dehydration will cause people to have hard, dry stools because the large intestine is trying to absorb as much liquid as it can to help the body be hydrated that it literally turns the stool into hard balls. So did you figure out why Arizonans are constipated? It's because we're always dehydrated from the heat and the lack of humidity. Those hard balls can be difficult and painful to pass out of the rectum. And if someone is constipated because they didn't have their normal bowel movement, then they may not have hard form stools. It may be their normal consistency and shape. It just may be that the frequency is less than what they're used to. So what kind of assessment findings do you think we're going to see with constipation? Well, first, we're going to notice that the patient's having less frequent bowel movements. We find this information out by either the patient being asked, like we ask them, hey, how many bowel movements are you having? Or from us cleaning the bed and the commode or flushing the toilet for them, and we're noticing that they're not having a bowel movement. I personally always ask people not to flush the toilet so I can assess what's in there. I know it sounds gross, but it's a great way to assess. Next, the patient may complain about abdominal distension, that feeling where it feels like their abdomen's growing, like they just feel like their belly's getting bigger. They may have abdominal pain and they may feel bloated. Sometimes people get so constipated that we can see the abdominal distension. The patient may say they don't feel like they've had a complete bowel movement, like they still have more to poop out. Some patients may have to strain when they have a bowel movement, which can cause rectal skin trauma, pain, and sometimes people bear down so hard and so long that they actually pass out. People may complain that they feel blocked up, like something won't let them have a bowel movement. We've already discussed that the stool may change and be hard and dry. The patient may also have decreased bowel sounds, especially if the constipation is caused by medications or a neurological condition that's affecting peristalsis. There are some diagnostics we can do to assess for constipation, like an abdominal x-ray, which is called a KUB, kidneys, ureter, bladder, or even a CT scan or an MRI, but the majority of the time, constipation is treated before they do diagnostics, unless they're ruling out a cause for the abdominal pain and they do an x-ray. Besides being uncomfortable, constipation can cause significant problems in the body. First, it can cause an issue called fecal impaction, where the stool actually turns rock hard and blocks up the bowels. We'll discuss this more in depth on the following slide. Pushing and straining from constipation can cause hemorrhoids, which are little pouches of blood vessels in the rectum that have the potential to not only cause significant pain, but also bleeding. Hemorrhoids are also chronic and they don't really go away. The symptoms of hemorrhoids can be lessened, but the only permanent solution is ending the constipation for good and surgical removal of the hemorrhoids. The pushing and straining can also cause anal fissures, where there are actual rips and tears in the anal skin. They're extremely painful. They heal incredibly slowly, and they get infected often due to the stool that comes in constant contact with it. If constipation goes on too long with too much straining and pushing, the patient can actually prolapse their rectum, which means the inside of the rectum comes outside of the body. And this can be a medical emergency, as that tissue is not meant to be outside the body, and it could potentially lose blood flow and die. Fecal impaction is a major complication of constipation because it takes good assessment skills to find, so it's often overlooked until the patient has significant problems. Fecal impaction is when the stool gets so hard inside the rectum that it actually forms a wall, stopping the stool from leaving the body. The hard, wedged stool is often causing a bowel obstruction, and we see this happen in patients who have not had a bowel movement in several days. They get so backed up with stool that they can become nauseous, they can get abdominal distension and cramping, and will often complain of rectal pain, like the rectum hurts from that hard stool in there. The telltale sign of fecal impaction that should clue the nurse into there's a problem going on is that the patient will start to ooze liquid stool. Most nurses are going to think that it's diarrhea and it's a good sign, but this is the type of oozing that doesn't stop. If we wipe the stool away, it just oozes right back out like a leaky faucet. They're not having diarrhea, and this is not a good sign. It means the body is doing everything possible to get the stool out, and all it can do is ooze liquid stool. We should not have liquid stool in the rectum. So this is the body's way of trying as hard as humanly possible to pass the stool, but it can't. Sadly, most nurses don't recognize that this is an impaction, and the patient gets sicker and sicker. If the nurse does realize what's going on, the nurse needs to digitally assess the rectum. Digital means using your digits, your fingers. You're going to lubricate your gloved finger, you're going to have the patient bear down, and you're going to insert your finger into the rectum. And when you do that, you're going to feel that hard impacted stool almost immediately. And sometimes you can see the hard impacted stool without even using a finger. The best way to remove this impaction is to digitally remove the stool. Use your finger to dig the stool out. This is not something that nurses should be doing without a provider's order, and it's not a skill that you're going to do in block one. The reason why we don't teach this skill to you, and the reason why we say you should probably have an order, is because there is a rare but real chance that that impaction could be caused by a rectal tumor, and we don't want to be digging around at tumors in the rectum, so it's best that we inform a provider first. So we know how constipation occurs, we know the symptoms they can have and the complications. Now let's discuss the outcomes we want for the patient who's dealing with constipation and what we can do for it. Remember, we have a nursing process, so we're going to follow that flow when we talk about this. If a patient is having constipation, they're not having regular bowel movements. That is their problem. Our outcomes are the opposite of our problems. So our outcome should be that the patient has a normal, soft, formed bowel movement, and hopefully without discomfort. We also want to help them not have any complications like skin issues with fissures or hemorrhoids. And we need to have a lot of educational goals for these patients. Something caused the diarrhea. So they need to know about diet choices and fluids and what they can do to improve or make the constipation worse. They need to know that they have to increase their fluids. They need to increase their activity levels. They also need to know that they need to see their provider if it comes back again so they don't have complications. They need to know not to resist the urge to have a bowel movement. If they feel the sensation, they need to go. They also need to know about the risk and benefits of using laxatives, which we'll discuss in a couple slides. There are several things that we can do to help constipation. We discuss digital removal of the stool with impaction, but we also have things that we can have the patient ingest, and we have things that go into the rectum. The most commonly ingested treatments are stool softeners and laxatives. Stool softeners work to increase water in the stool so it gets softer and easier to pass. Dietary fiber can do the same thing, so we definitely need to educate our patient to increase dietary fiber as a way to treat and prevent constipation. Laxatives work differently. They actually work on the muscles of the colon to increase peristalsis. They are not without their risks, and they can cause abdominal pain, diarrhea, dehydration, and even dependency, meaning the muscles start to need the laxatives to work. We sometimes call really strong laxatives cathartics. It's best to figure out the cause of the constipation before turning to laxatives or cathartics, but in real life, depending on the provider, they may give the laxative and just go from there. The reason why it's best to figure out the cause is if there's so many reasons why we could have constipation. And if they're constipated because it's a tumor or a bowel obstruction or an impaction, the laxatives aren't going to do anything, and they may make the patient in more pain and more discomfort. We also want to make sure we assess our patient before giving the laxative. Listen to bowel sounds, check for abdominal distension, assess their pain, assess for nausea and vomiting. Those are all important things that we need to know about before we give a laxative. Another method is to put medications and fluids directly into the rectum. We do this in the form of enemas or rectal suppositories. There are several different types of enemas and rectal suppositories, so we'll discuss each of them on another slide. The two most common types of stool softeners are bulk forming and emollients. Bulk forming, like Metamucil, are stool softeners that absorb water and make the stool less hard and bigger. Because it's bigger, it pushes on the intestinal wall and stimulates peristalsis to hopefully cause the stool to be pushed out a little easier. For these to work, the patient has to have adequate hydration, so they have to drink water. If they're dehydrated at all, these aren't going to work. They also do not work immediately, so it could be a few days before the patient has relief. These are best used at home or to prevent constipation from reoccurring. The second type of stool softener, emollients, like docusate sodium or colase, work by lowering the surface tension of the stool so water and fat can enter into the stool, making it softer, bigger, and easier to slide out of the rectum. These are used a lot in healthcare settings, especially after surgery or childbirth, when we don't want the person to strain while they're pushing. In some people, stool softeners can cause abdominal pain and diarrhea with repeat doses, so we do have to watch our patient's bowel movements. There are different types of laxatives, both orally and by rectum. The most common oral laxative is a chemical stimulant called bisacodyl or Ducalax. This one also comes in suppository form. Bisacodyl works by irritating the intestinal mucosa to cause increased peristalsis and bowel movements. This causes decreased absorption in the small intestines and colon because the peristalsis speeds up so much that there will be a loss of nutrients and the intestines don't have enough time to absorb the fluids and the nutrients from the stool. So the result is often diarrhea after the harder stool is passed. This will cause abdominal cramping that can become severe and sometimes can cause nausea. We try not to use these as the first option, but is often used as a way to clear the bowel out quickly for diagnostic procedures where the bowels need to be empty. Oral bisacodyl has more side effects than rectal as it's passing through the entire GI tract, and rectally just gets absorbed by the large intestines and has less of an effect on the small intestines. We try not to use these long-term as they can lead to diarrhea, which can lead to dehydration, electrolyte imbalances, and malnutrition on top of dependence, where the patient's requiring more and more laxatives to have the same effect. In addition to chemical laxatives like bisacodyl, we have saline laxatives. Some of these can also be given rectally as an enema. Saline laxatives work to quickly add water to the stool to help it increase in size and push on the intestinal wall to increase peristalsis, just like bulk stool softeners, but they work much faster in a different way. They inhibit water absorption by the intestine and increase water and electrolyte secretion from the bowel walls. This causes a large amount of water to enter in the stool, really increasing peristalsis and lubrication so it can quickly leave the body. magnesium citrate, Miralax, milk of magnesia, Fleet's phosphosoda, and Fleet's enemas are all types of saline laxatives. They're also used to clean out the bowels for diagnostic procedures. We do have to use these with caution for people with renal issues or on fluid restriction because they cause major shifts in fluids and electrolytes, and it could cause damage to the kidneys, especially if someone already has kidney damage. The last type of laxative we have are lubricants like mineral oil. These laxatives coat the stool in oil so they slide out of the colon faster and easier. They also prevent water absorption, so the stool is going to keep the water that it already has in it. It's not going to have any water absorbed back into the colon. Mineral oil usually works very quickly and very well, and it also prevents straining, but it's not without its risks. It's going to decrease absorption of fat-soluble vitamins, so malnutrition can occur with repeat use, and it also has the same dependency issues and abdominal pain as the other types of laxatives. There are several types of enemas used for different reasons, but when it comes to constipation, we typically use saline enemas like Fleet's enemas or warm water or even warm water with soap enemas. These types of enemas increase fluid in the rectum and sigmoid colon to distend the colon, to increase peristalsis, irritate the intestinal mucosa, and flush out the stool. Enemas usually work great, but they do have risks. Of course, we have the risk of dependency and abdominal pain, but because we're actually putting something into the rectum, we could cause rectal or colon damage, which could cause bleeding and increase the risk of infection through the broken tissue. They can also cause major changes with fluid and electrolytes, so we could cause kidney damage in someone whose kidneys are already having difficulties, just like with saline laxatives. Enemas are also contraindicated in people with bowel obstructions. They can work well for rectal impactions, but most of the time we can't get the enema past that hardened stool until we've digitally disimpacted some of it. And then remember several slides ago when I said we should be looking for the cause of the constipation before we treat it? Bowel obstructions and tumors are the reason why. If the patient has a bowel obstruction, the enema won't do anything to resolve that obstruction, and it's just going to delay the required care for that obstruction. If the patient has a rectal or sigmoid colon tumor, we could actually perforate the tumor and cause major damage and even death. And this is the end of constipation.